Hello everyone, today we are going to start the new topic, which is principal stress and strain. So far we have seen the topic like various types of stresses and strain, which includes the compressive, tensile and volumetric strain. So the next topic is the principal stress. So next thing is that why we are studying these principal stresses, though we have studied all these type of stresses. So the thing and most important thing is that if we are analyzing the any specimen, let's say suppose that if we are analyzing this specimen and if it is subjected to the tensile stresses or compressive stresses or a combination of the shear and tensile or a combination of tensile, compressive and shear. So if all such kind of a combination of stresses if being applied on a any specimen, and if we want to study at any cross section, let's say suppose GF or EFs, then what will be the forces, let's say tensile and normal stresses, that going to be act on that plane. So if we want to do certain kind of studies, then we could just need to go through this topic of principal stresses and strain, and they will just make us understand the importance of the study of all those stresses. So the next thing is that what are the principal stresses. So the plane which is having no shear stress are the principal planes. So any plane which doesn't have at all shear stresses, that stresses are known as principal stress. So we are left with only one type of stress, which is normal stress. So basically principal stresses are nothing but these are the normal stresses which are acting on the planes which are known as principal planes, on which there are no any shear stresses. So in order to just determine the stresses, we have this two methods, analytical method and graphical method, and your syllabus you have to go through this analytical method, and this is not is in your syllabus. And then we will look into the Mohr circle and then 3D state of the stresses and stress, and then generalized hook law. Okay, so in this case, at first we are going to start with a simple case study of any specimen if it is subjected to a tensile forces on this plane. So let us suppose that we have just cut this section at the section of EF, and at that section we need to find out the stress. So stress is simple as force over area. So we know the force P over A, so that will be the stress which will be acting on this plane EF. But that is the simple case, but the complexity arises when this plane is not at 90 degree, but that plane is at an oblique angle of, let's say, angle of theta. And if now it is asked in the examination that now at this plane GF we have to calculate the normal stresses, which is Pn and the tensile, sorry, sigma n. Now if it is said that now we have to calculate the normal stress which is acting on this plane, that is sigma n, and the tensile stress acting on this plane, which is sigma t. So in order to calculate that, we need to go through certain derivation. Let us first go through this and then we will move forward to this case. Okay, so in this case the simple stress is P over A, because this plane EF is at an angle of 90 degree with the other plane, and consequently if you want to find the area of this section of EF which is having a unit thickness of 1, in this case the area of this section will be simply FG into 1. Okay, so now if we want to find out the area section of FG, if you want to find out the area of this EF, that will be equals to EF length into times 1. Okay, that is EF times into 1, that is its area. But if you want to find out the area of this, the area will be equals to its length into its thickness. Thickness is 1, so what is its length? So length can be found out using the triangle principle, which states that cos theta is equal to base over hypotenuse. So we will use this formula and then we will calculate the this length GF, and that is equals to the this this case, I think, which is this GF or FG equals to EF over cos theta. Then you just put the value over here of, and then the area of cross section of FG is equals to A over cos theta. And then you just need to, if you want to find out the stress over this, then that will be equals to force over area. We know the force is P that is acting on this plane and area is this, and that equation gets reduced to sigma cos theta. Okay, now we will just move into the more complex thing, like if you want to find now the normal stress and the tangential stress which is acting on this oblique plane. Okay, so if you want to find out the normal and tangential stress, stress is force over area. We need to find the force and area. We know the area of the section that we have calculated just now. So we, the only requirement is this force. So if we know the value of the force divided by the area, you will get the value of the tangential and normal stress. So in this case, the normal force is denoted by Pn and the tangential force is denoted by Pt. Okay, so this is P, and so its component in this direction will be P cos theta, and in this case it will be P 90 minus theta, that is P sine 90 minus theta, and sine 90 minus theta is that is equals to cos theta. Okay, so in this case the component which will come in this direction will be P cos theta, and in this case it will be P cos 90 minus theta, which is equals to P sine theta. Okay, as you can see here, it is P sine theta and it is P cos theta over here. So just you just place the value over there, then you will get the value of normal stress sigma cos square theta and sigma by 2 sine 2 theta. That is a very simple case. So in the next case we will just going to study about the case in which this specimen is being subjected to the tensile forces in mutually perpendicular direction. Again, we have this oblique plane. This is and this is the normal stress, and this is the tangential stress. And again, we need to find out this normal stress and tangential stress. Simple, we need to know the force over area. Okay, we know the value of the area is its length multiplied by its unit thickness. So ultimately, we have to find the normal force and the tangential force. Okay, so let us consider this case that this is the sigma 1 and this is sigma 2 stress which is acting on this place due to the action of P1 force over here and P2 force over here. Okay, so this is P1 and this is P2 force over here. So if we resolve this P1 in this direction and this direction which is perpendicular and tangential to this plane, then this P1 here will be P1 cos theta, and this will be P1 that will be P1 sine theta. Okay, or you can say P1 cos 90 minus, that is equals to P1 sine theta. Okay, again P2 force is acting in downward direction, so its component here will be P2 cos theta in this tangential direction, and in this direction it will go P2 sine theta. Okay, and now you are going to do one thing, that the net force acting in this perpendicular direction and net force acting in this tangential direction. So the net force acting in this direction will be equals to the summation of both of them, which is equals to P1 cos theta plus P2 sin theta, and the force acting in this tangential direction will be P1 sin theta and P2 cos theta. It will be minus because it is acting in opposite direction. So you just need to add these values over here, and the case of normal, in the case of tangential, you are just going to add this value over here and just put the sign convention, and then you will get the value of the normal stress as well as tangential stress. Normal stress will be sigma 1 plus sigma 2 over 2 plus sigma 1 minus sigma 2 over 2 cos 2 theta, and the tangential will be sigma 1 minus sigma 2 over 2 sine 2 theta. Okay, and if you want to find out the value of the resultant stress, that is sigma r, which will be equals to the under square of the sigma n square plus sigma t square. Okay, and if you want to find out the angle which is between the this is the angle phi, if you want to find the angle which is between this resultant and this normal, then you can use this formula tan phi equals to sigma t over sigma 1, that is base over perpendicular. Okay, this is phi and this is its perpendicular over base. So tan phi is perpendicular over base, and it is perpendicular given over here, that is sigma t, and the base is sigma n. Okay. Similarly, you can also find out the maximum shear stress, and if you want to find out the maximum shear stress, then whatever the value, if you want to find this needs to be maximum, then this sine theta 2 theta needs to be maximum, and this will be maximum when this theta equals to 45 degree or 135 degree, and its maximum value will be 1. So the maximum shear stress value will be equals to sigma 1 minus sigma 2 over 2, and it's these two planes will be, and the plane of the maximum shear stress will be at an angle of 45 or 135 degree. Okay, so next, if you want to find out the principal plane, then again you have to put this equation to zero, because on a principal plane shear stress is zero. Then you will get the value that theta is zero and theta is 90 degree. It means that this sigma n equals to sigma 1 and this sigma n equals to sigma 2 at both of this angle, and at this angle this is the value of the normal stress. So we get an idea that if mutually perpendicular forces are acting on this specimen, then we had calculated value of normal and shear stresses, and then resultant stress and the maximum shear stress, and then the principal planes principal stresses, and correspondingly at an angle of 0 degree and at an angle of 90 degree, the normal stress will be equals to the sigma 1 and sigma 2. The next and the last case is when the normal stress is the next case is when only the shear stress is acting and no normal component of the stress is acting on this plane. Only and only shear stresses are acting on this plane. Okay, so in that case again we have to do the same thing. That will be oblique plane, which is at an angle theta degree, and then again we are going to just resolve the forces in this direction, and then we are going to get the normal and the tangential component on the on that oblique plane, which will be equals to tau sine 2 theta, and the tangential force will be tangential stress will be minus tau cos 2 theta. Okay. And the last case is when this normal and the shear force, normal stress are acting and the shear stresses are also acting. And this case again we will do the same thing as we have done in the previously. Again we will just resolve the component of the forces in one direction, and then we will add them both together and divide it by area. Then you will get the value of normal stress equals to this formula and tangential stress equals to the this formula. And if you want to find out the position of the principal plane, we know that for the principal stress here, stress is equals to zero. Put the value equals to zero, you will get this equation, that is tan 2 theta equals to 2 tau over sigma 1 minus sigma 2. And by the help of this you can draw a triangle. Since this tan 2 theta equals to perpendicular upon base, you just put these two value over here, then you will calculate this value of hypotenuse. Then you will find that there are two values of the hypotenuse. Okay, and from this figure you can calculate sine 2 theta and cos 2 theta. Put this sine 2 theta and cos 2 theta value in the normal stresses, and then you will get the value of the two stresses, and this strain, this value is known as major principal stress. And you put, and when you put the diagonal value of lesser value and put the this value over here, and again put this value in the normal stress value, then you will get the lesser value, that is minor principal stress value, which is equals to this. So both of these are almost equal, but it is having positive and this is having negative sign. So this is major and this is minor principal stresses. Okay, and if you want to find out the, and this is the figure that is in this equation, this is the equation of the major and this is minor principal stresses, and this gives major and this is giving the minimum principal stress value, and both of them will be an angle of 90 degree. As you can see from here that both of these principal planes are at an angle of 90 degree with each other. Okay, in next thing is that this is very important in the from the point of view of end semester examination. They used to ask this derivation. So you can just remember this derivation, which states that how we can determine the maximum shear stress. So the shear stress, as it was given by this equation, so that could be maximum or minimum when its derivative is equals to zero. Correspondingly, when you just differentiate it, you will get this equation. This is equal to tan 2 theta. Use this equation to draw this triangle. After drawing this triangle, you will get sine 2 theta, cos 2 theta, perpendicular of upon hypotenuse, base upon hypotenuse. Again, using these two values, just put them in the equation of the shear stress, and then you can get the maximum value of the shear stress, which is half under root of sigma 1 minus sigma 2 square plus 4 tau square, and these two values differ by an angle of 90 degree. Okay, so this was all the four cases, and you just need to remember the last equation that we obtained from all of these cases. Okay, and the next topic is about the Mohr circles. So you can just go through all those numericals, and if you find in any problem, just you can tell to me, I will just help you out. So the next is about the Mohr circle. So as you have seen, the analytical method of obtaining the principal and the shear stresses, similarly there was also a proposal that was given by the Mohr, which and he used the concept of the Mohr circle in order to obtain those value of the normal and the shear stresses for all these three cases, whether they are mutually perpendicular to each other, whether the stresses are tensile or uncompressive, and whether on a body a mutually perpendicular tensile or tensile or compressive is being accompanied by the shear stress. So for all these particular three cases, he has given the Mohr circle, and just we go through it one by one. So in the first case is the case of when two mutually perpendicular tensile of unequal entities are being applied over this applied over any specimen. So this Mohr, he just drew a circle, and just he derived the equation of the tangential stress as well as normal stresses that we have just seen right now. Okay, these are the same equation just we have seen in the previous slides. Okay, so what he just did, he just drew a circle which was having a value of sigma 1 and sigma 2. These are the values of the tensile stresses. Then he just drawn this line CE at an angle of theta, and he drawn this line OE at an angle of 2 theta, and then he drawn a perpendicular from this point, that is ED, and based upon his geometry, he just put all those values over here, and that's it. Then he just derived the equation of the normal and tangential stress. Similarly, if in the examination the data are given, you just need to put the values over here, and then you can just get the answer. In the next case, what he did was the two mutually perpendicular principal stress with unequal and unlike, so it might could be either tensile or compressive force. So if you are considering about the compressive force, then he said it will be a negative intensity. For the positive, it will be a positive intensity. Again, if it is positive, that will be sigma 1 value. If it is negative, that will be a sigma 2 value, which are denoted by this AB and AC. Again, then he just drew a line AE which is having an angle of phi. Again, a line which is having an angle of 2 phi, then draw a perpendicular bisector, and correspondingly he just put the volume, all the values for this radius of Mohr circle, and then he just derived the formula of the shear stress as well as normal stress that we have seen in the previous analytical method, and then he just obtained. And if you just put the value of this normal and compressive stress in this equation, then you will get the value of this sigma 1 and sigma 2 value. So if it is asked, then you can just solve this numerical very easily. Similarly, the last case when the mutual forces is being accompanied by the shear stress, again it's just a Mohr circle with all these sigma 1 sigma 2 value, and then he just derived this formula of the tangential and the normal stress. That this is the same formula that we have seen in our previous slide. So and then again he just derived the equation for the minimum value of the normal stress that we have seen in the previous. So the Mohr also, he has given the concept for the derivation of the normal and the shear stresses which are being act on an oblique plane. So, and then these are the numericals which you can again go one by one and just make a note of that. So if you just go through the conclusion, then you just make a note of all those formula just you have seen just now, whether it is this formula when the tensile or compressive force are being applied on one plane, or if it is applying on the two plane, or if it is the case when mutually direct stresses are being applied on the plane, or if it is a case when mutual direct stresses are being accompanied by the shear stress. So these are the formula, and these are the case of major and minor principal stresses. Similarly, the case of the maximum shear stress, you need to remember all these formula by heart, so that if in the examination certain numerical portion are being asked on this formula, then you can just solve all those numericals. So next thing, it is about the equilibrium equation and the generalized hook law. So this topic, which is generalized, I think it is 3D state of the strain and strain. Okay, so the next topic is 3D state of strain and strain. Basically, this topic is a master's topic. When you will do the master's in either structure or CEM, then you will study this topic, where you will find the 3D analysis of any 3D object. So let us just go in a brief, so that you won't find any difficulty if you study on your own. Okay, so let us consider that this is a 3D body and you are going to do a 3D analysis of that. So far we have done a 2D analysis, but if you want to do a 3D analysis, let us suppose that on this body, sigma z, sigma x and sigma y, these are the normal stresses which are being applied on this body. Okay, and now these are the normal stresses which are being applied, and these tau zx and tau zy, similarly these values over here, these are the shear stresses which are being developed on this surface. Okay, so if it is tau xz, then it means that the shear stress which is due to this normal stress z in the direction of x. Similarly, the same denomination holds for this case also. So in totality, we have got 1, 2, and 3. We have got 3 normal stresses, and we have got 6 tangential stresses, and in this case these tau xy equals to tau yz. Similarly, all these cases are equal. So we have got basically these 3 sigma x, sigma y and sigma z normal stresses, and rest of these tau xy, tau yz, tau xz, tau zx, tau yz and tau zy, these are the 6 shear stresses which acts on the plane. So if you want to do a 3D analysis of any 3D object, then these will be the 3 normal stresses and these will be the 6 shearing stresses. So if you do a master in either structure or construction engineering, then you will be doing this type of analysis, and detailed analysis will be done in the masters, because this is a master's topic. Okay, so next topic is about the equilibrium equation and the generalized hook law. So what is basically this equilibrium equation is that, so if you want to talk about this equilibrium, then this is the at equilibrium, the sum of the forces in any direction will be zero. So if you consider this figure, okay, so and if this is an oblique plane, so if you want to talk about the equation of equilibrium, then it states that the sum of the forces in any direction must be zero, that is horizontal force minus this tau cos alpha minus n sin alpha will be a zero, and if this condition holds over there, then only you are going to say that this is the equation of equilibrium. Similarly, in the vertical direction also, this is an equation of equilibrium. So for equation of equilibrium, the sum of forces in any direction should be zero. If that happens, then you can say that this is an equation of equilibrium. Okay, So then the next topic is about the generalized hook law. I think I have covered this generalized hook law in our previous tutorial video. We have seen about that. I will just go through that quickly so that you can just watch that again. Okay, so this is the three-dimensional stress system, and we have just calculated the values of the strain, whether it is E1, E2, and E3, where this sigma 1 over E, this, and sigma 2, sigma 3 over E, these are the longitudinal strains, and these are the lateral strain. Okay, so if you just add all of these strain together, that will be strain E1, this will be strain E2, this will be strain E3. So this equation is only a generalized Hooke's law in the case of the 3D. If you are studying a 3D, then you will be using this equation for the strain. The same is being depicted over here, that is EX, EY, and EZ. This is the longitudinal strain over here, this is the longitudinal strain, and this is the longitudinal strain. Similarly, these are the lateral strain, these are the lateral strain, and this minus minus, these are the lateral strain. If you add all of them together, they you will get the strain in the X direction, in the Y direction, and in the Z direction. So this is basically the generalized Hooke's law in the case of the 3D. Okay, so these are the few topics that have been covered today, and in the next and last tutorial video of the unit first, we are going to study about the theory of failure and the factor of safety, and then we will conclude this first unit. And again, we will have a validatory session in which you can ask certain questions if you have any. And again, if you have any doubts and queries regarding the topics which have been covered, you can just text me or mail me. I will just help you solve your problem. Okay, thank you.